appreciate everybody coming this afternoon. I'm only going to talk for 1 minute. First of all, to thank everybody who has been involved in this, especially our participants. For this presentation, Henry Puente, who is a professor at Cal State Fullerton, is going to be moderating. He'll be introducing everybody. He'll also be leading our question and answer at the end of this time. And he's going to keep strict control over everybody. They only go 25 minutes, so we actually can ask a few questions afterwards.
I'll do my best.
Yeah, you're going to take control with an iron hand.
Definitely
going to
do it.
In any case, so we have literally, if they dropped a bomb on Annenberg today, the future of gender research in sports would pretty much be over. We've got virtually every top person around sitting in the room right now. So we should have a really interesting conversation on a bunch of issues. We appreciate you coming. This is the first full day of activities, or at least relatively full day. Tomorrow will be significantly fuller. But we hope you enjoy your time. And Henry Puente of California State University Fullerton. Thank you.
All right. Hey, Dan. So I'm really pleased. Welcome everybody to the Media, Gender, and Sports Image, Representation, and Title IX panel. I'm very honored and pleased to, first and foremost, present good old Mike here, Mike Messner, a professor of sociology at USC. We have in the middle Cheryl Cooky, assistant professor at Purdue University. And over to the very far left, we have Mary Jo Kane, a professor of sociology at Purdue University. University of Minnesota, sorry. So first and foremost, each of these panelists are going to speak for about 20 to 25 minutes, and I will keep them on task. So we'll have a Q&A shortly after all their presentations. So we'll start with Mary Jo.
I don't know.
Yes.
Is it on?
Good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. I want to first, before I begin my formal remarks, want to thank the Annenberg Institute for Sport, Media, and Society, and also the director, Dan Durbin, and a particular thanks to John Hackett, who is behind the scenes an unsung hero, actually getting me here, helping to get me here yesterday from Minneapolis, where we had a foot of snow on the ground. So that was a lot of fun. Okay, so what I'm going to do today is share with you a study that we've just completed and had published online. You can read the title of the article. And I also want to acknowledge my co-authors on this particular study, Nicole Lavoie from the University of Minnesota and Janet Fink from UMass Amherst. Let me just give you just a very brief introduction and lit review. For the past 30 years plus, sport media scholarship reveals that portrayals of sportswomen emphasize femininity and sexuality far more than they emphasize their athletic competence. And I'm citing Liz Daniels here, but as Henry and Dan mentioned, there are people in this room who've contributed greatly to this body of knowledge. What scholars are saying is that the impact of such portrayals tends to marginalize and trivialize female athletes. And I want to just emphasize the universality of these results across these 30 years, which has been really quite remarkable. On the one hand, female athletes represent 40% of all athletes who participate in this country, and yet research by Mike Messner and others indicate that they receive about 2% of the overall coverage. And the second pattern is, again, that when they are covered, they're much more likely than their male counterparts to be portrayed off the court, out of uniform, and in highly sexualized poses. And what's also important about this is that it hasn't mattered whether we've looked at print and broadcast journalism, whether we're now looking at the internet, net, and new media, whether or not we look at Olympic athletes, intercollegiate athletes, professional athletes, these two trends are quite remarkable and resilient. Nevertheless, there are some limitations of this past research. Until recently, little research has been done on how various audiences interpret these media portrayals outside of what scholars say these images do. So in the last, I'd say, 5 years, what I'm going to call second wave media research has moved beyond content analysis and examined audiences based on their age, their race, their gender, and their sport background, among other variables. And one overlooked and highly salient group is elite female athletes. So therefore, the purpose of our study was we looked at Division I female athletes and asked them to respond to the various ways they're represented in the media, ranging from on-court competence to off-court nude and semi-nude poses. And we employed reception research, where the viewer who's looking at the image not only deconstructs the meaning of the text, but how that meaning for them impacts their attitudes and their intentions to act towards a particular subject. And the subject that we were interested in is gender identity, and how the gender identity of a female athlete may influence their media interpretations. As many of us know, media discourses need to be analyzed within a broader framework of sociocultural identities. And sportswomen are very aware of their dual and contradictory identities as females and athletes. Whether they embrace a dual identity or whether they reject a dual identity, they are very aware that they have a dual identity in terms of how they're seen by the larger culture. So what we were interested in is how do these elite female athletes balance and negotiate their traditional female identities with their athletic ones? And we also argue that sport media is fertile analytic ground to gain key information regarding how these negotiations are interpreted and understood. So the key questions that we asked for our study were the following. Would the need to balance a dual identity impact how elite female athletes wish to be portrayed? Do they prefer images as in-action, highly gifted, competent athletes, or off-the-court, sexy babes? Or both images, depending upon the circumstances. The theoretical framework we used to conduct and frame this study was we employed critical feminist theory, because a fundamental assumption of critical feminist theory is that society is structured around inequitable and gendered relationships of power, where females are systematically marginalized and devalued. And because sport sits at the intersection of gender, privilege, and power, among other variables like race and class, it becomes an ideal site for this particular analytic framework to look at, again, how do elite female athletes interpret the ways in which they are portrayed in the media. Now, I just want to quickly go through the methodology that we used, because we were literally, figuratively breaking new ground in terms of doing this kind of research, because, again, so few folks have been engaged in this research. We had a mixed method research design where we got quantitative data in the form of frequency distributions, and I'll share with you what I mean by that when I get to the results, and qualitative data in the form of verbal text from probes that we used when we interviewed these elite female athletes. And in terms of those verbal texts, we employed critical discourse analysis to kind of figure out what the patterns were that emerged from the data, from the verbal data. We collected data from two large public universities from the Midwest and Northeast regions, or if you promise not to tell anybody, the University of Minnesota and the University of Connecticut. Our study participants were a convenient sample of 36 elite female athletes, all of whom were Division I scholarship athletes. That was our operational definition of elite female athletes. They were Division I scholarship athletes, and their breakdown racially was 83% white, 17% African American. We recruited participants from six sports, three individual sports, and three team sports. And the reason that we did this is because recent research has shown how resilient Eleanor Matheny's classic gendered sport typology is. And for those of you who do not know, what Eleanor Matheny said in the mid-1960s was the following. I'm giving you the Cliff's Notes version, but in effect, what she said was, it's not that female athletes aren't allowed to play sports. It's that when a female athlete participates in sports, how she will be perceived in the society, whether she's stigmatized or accepted, depends on whether or not the physical requirements of the sport requires her to either transgress gender norms or to be comfortable within gender norms. So you can be a female athlete and play golf and tennis and not challenge gender norms of traditional femininity. But when you start playing sports like basketball and hockey, rugby, and others, then you are much more likely to be stigmatized. So what we were interested in, especially how it relates to the notion of dual identity and how elite female athletes negotiated that, would it matter whether or not you were in a more socially acceptable sport or a less socially acceptable sport in terms of gender norms? And then finally, we interviewed three athletes from each sport at both schools. In terms of the interview protocol, we had one-on-one, face-to-face, semi-structured interviews. And we randomly showed them four exemplar images from their sport. And I'm going to show you in a minute what I mean by exemplar images. And so we only asked tennis players to react to images of tennis players, okay? Because we wanted them to comment about their own particular sport. And so they're in a room. We put four exemplar images representing categories of representation, which I'm going to show you in the next couple of slides. And then we asked them four questions while those images are in front of them. We said, which of these four images best represents how you want to be portrayed, represents how you want your sport to be portrayed, increases interest in your sport, increases respect for your sport? Now, the categories and definitions of representation, what the research that I have done, again, along with folks in this room, from Mike Messner to Cheryl to Don and to Sherry Dworkin and others, have found some. We used four categories of representation, so I'm going to tell you what they are and then what the definition is. The first is images of female athletes that we call or code as athletic competence. That's images of women on court, in action, where the emphasis is on your athleticism. The next is what's called a mixed message. And here, there's something, you're off the court and you're in a posed image. There's some athletic marker in the image, but the emphasis primarily is on your femininity, how pretty you are. The next is what we called sexy, classy lady. And here, this is an off-court posed image with no athletic marker, in fashionable attire, sort of red carpet kind of an image. And then finally, soft pornography, where the image of the female athlete, she's off court, she's posed in an image that emphasizes sexual objectification, either nude or semi-nude. Now, what happened is that the three of us who were doing this study, you know, we went on the Google, and you just type in, you know, googleimages.com or women's images of women's tennis, whatever, and the three of us knew in advance, obviously, what the definitions were, and so independently, we picked two or three images that we thought were great exemplar images for each one of these categories. We came back together and talked about which images we wanted to use until we reached consensus. Now, in the interest of time, I don't have time to go through all of the images that we used, but I'll first show you the images that were shown to the tennis players and the images that were shown to the basketball players, again, based on these definitions. So for tennis, they saw that image for competence, the mixed message image, the sexy, classy lady image, and soft porn. For basketball, they saw competence. For mixed message, sexy, classy lady. That's a shout out to USC for those of you who. And the soft porn image for the sport of basketball. Okay, results. Now remember, the first question that we asked them is, how would you like to be portrayed? And again, they're sitting in a room. They have these four images in front of them where it was randomly presented to them. So the question was, which one of these images best represents how you would most like to be portrayed? I should start out by telling you there were no differences between Minnesota and Connecticut, so I'm not going to talk about gender differences or differences between the schools. But an unexpected but highly relevant finding was the following. Half of them said to the researcher, can I pick more than one image? And we said, of course, because as good scholars, you follow the data trail, and said, of course you can pick more than one image. So what I'm going to present to you as I go through the frequency distributions in terms of what they picked, I'm going to first show you what we call single response participants, meaning those female athletes who just picked one image, and multiple response participants, meaning those who asked to pick more than one image, usually just two in a combination. So, okay, the question is, how would you best like to be portrayed of those four images that you've seen? 90% of them said competence, and 11 said the mixed message. Now, of the other 18 who said, can I pick more than one, here's what they picked in combination. So you see that they competence mixed, competence lady, and here's obviously the notion when we talk to them about their choices where the whole issue of dual identity comes into play. They would say things like, I want to be well-rounded, I don't want to just be seen as a kind of a dirty, sweaty jock, because I'm both a jock, but I'm also, you know, a lady, I'm a girl, and I want to be pretty, and I want to be feminine, and I don't want to be seen pigeonholed as just a jock. Okay, best represents your sport. Here of the 36, 28 of them chose a single response, and the other 8 chose a multiple response. And of those who chose a single response in terms of what image best represented their sport, 96% of them chose competence. Of the 8 who asked to pick more than one image, competence and the mixed message image. So again, competence shows up again, but around this notion of a dual identity. With respect to the third question we asked them, which image best increases respect for your sport, 23 of the 36 picked a single response, and 13 of them picked a multiple response. So for those 23 who picked just one image, that's what they picked. And for the 13 who asked to pick more than one image, here were their combination of choices. Again, competence mixed, competence lady, where you see this notion of a dual identity. Now, the last question was, which image best increases interest in your sport? Have you noticed anything about what image has not been picked so far? The only image that was not picked so far was the soft porn image. But here is the question where soft porn gets picked, and the whole notion when you talk with the female athletes about this, where the notion of sex sells first services and is very much in play. 18, again, we had an 18-18 split on this, not necessarily the same participants. 18 had a single response, 18 asked for a multiple response, and basically they were marketers. They said, well, it depends on who your audience is, and it depends on what you want to do. And when they picked soft pornography, who do you think their audience was? Males. Okay, so for those who picked a single response, this is what they picked. They still picked competence, but the second most often picked was the soft porn image. And then for those who asked to pick more than one image, that was the breakdown. So they were not only involved in marketing, but they were involved in market segmentation. I mean, that wasn't the word that they used. They didn't say, well, we need to do market segmentation. But they did talk about marketing and how best to increase interest in women's sports. So let me just take you through some key findings and discussion. I think the first key takeaway is that competence matters. It was the number one choice for self-representation, represents your sport, and increases respect for your sport. And in that, so just this is, I'm going to give you a quote from a swimmer, so I wanted you to see the competence image that she saw, that the swimmer saw. That was the competence image. I think the second point here is that it's, in this way, competence served as what I call the anchor choice in both the single and multiple responses. And when we ask the elite athletes, why is it that you chose competence so often? Why was that the number one choice for you? They said things like the in-action on-court images are reality-based. And they are reality-based. These were the three themes that came up when we said, well, what do you mean by reality-based? Well, they show our skill and talent. They show our hard work. And they show our dedication. This is from Kelly responding to the image about the action image that I just showed you, which is an incredibly powerful, I think, and moving image. Here's what she said. This action photo is intense, it's determined, and it's strong. And I like that picture a lot because the most grueling part about swimming is the racing and the competing. And you can tell that she's probably thinking about what I've thought in races, which is I am going to keep going no matter what. Now, the second key takeaway is that clearly dual identity was revealed, and particularly for those who were what we call multiple response participants. But I also want to say that there were other female athletes. Oh, sorry, this would be a mixed message image, and this was for those who played softball. Okay, so that was the mixed message that they saw, and I'm showing you this because I'm going to give you a quote in a little bit. But I also want to say that there were other female athletes, although they were in the minority, who actively resisted the notion of a dual identity. And they would say things like, I'm very proud of who I am, and I don't have to apologize for being a female athlete, and I don't feel a need to get all, you know, dolled up and girlied up. That's not who I am, and I don't need to do that. But they were in the minority. This is, interestingly enough, around these multiple participants. This was the only place where the team versus individual differences emerged. So, for example, 12 of 15, we went back through and we said, okay, are they talking about dual identity in language? Are they resisting it? Are they embracing it? What are they doing? Are they neutral about it? What was interesting was of the 15 who clearly embraced a dual identity role, 12 of them were from team sports. The other thing I should tell you is that 8 of them did not talk about a dual identity at all until we probed them at the end of the interview about the whole issue of dual identity. Of those 8 who never mentioned dual identity at all, 7 were from individual sports. And this is where Crane has talked about for these dual identity females, the notion of needing to perform femininity. Scholars have talked about that in ways that aren't terribly flattering. But I can tell you for these women, they're not running around being tortured about their dual identity. They don't see it as transgressive at all. They embrace it. And in fact, Sherry Dworkin has talked about this quite a bit. Let me give you from first Natalie, a hockey player who very much embraces the notion of, oh, wait, I'm sorry. This is the last thing I want to talk about is the notion of increasing interest. And again, this was the only area where soft porn images emerged. Let me also, I'm sorry, give you a quote from Katie, the softball player, who was reacting to that mixed message of the female athlete in the evening gown. Here's what Katie said. She looks powerful, but at the same time, she looks great. And she looks pretty and elegant. So it's kind of a really nice mix. And this is, again, this notion of a dual identity. In terms of the only area where the soft porn image is seen as a viable option, I have two quotes from hockey players. So I want you to see the soft porn image the hockey players saw. And this quote is from Natalie. And she says the following about this image. If you're talking about who's going to pay attention to the advertisement, I'd pick this image because you're going to get every guy out there staring at that picture for at least a minute and a half. Okay, I'm going to be way, that'll be no problem. Target marketing, again, for this question was clearly seen as the issue here. And many did embrace the notion of sex sells, meaning almost all of them said, yeah, sex sells to guys. There's no problem about that. But here's what they also said. In fact, there were only 5 out of 36 who said sex does not sell. But even for those who said that sex sells women's sports, here's what they said. Many of them said it was counterproductive in the long run, and they said it was counterproductive because of this. It alienates your core fan base of girls and women and families, especially families around the whole notion of dads with daughters. And it you lose respect, and you're not taken seriously as an athlete. And this is from Betty, also a hockey player, and she made precisely this point, talking about that soft porn image. She said, if this is all we have to offer, it's not hockey, it's about sex. So people will look at it and think we have to sell this kind of image to make it interesting, and that's just not true. We are good athletes, but if we go around selling sex, people will think that we are a joke. Okay, let me just finish my remarks by talking about the notion of resisting a sex sells narrative. In this one key takeaway I think we can come from the second wave media research is that sex sells sex, not women's sports. And I say that because even the research that's talking to 18 to 34-year-old males, like a study that I did before this, Kane and Maxwell, what the 18 to 34-year-old male said is, we'd buy the magazine. we'll go to the GoDaddy ad for Danica Patrick, but that doesn't make us more interested in NASCAR because that's not what she looks like. So on the one hand, you're alienating your core fan base of women and families, but you're not bringing in all these males because they're buying images that see women's bodies as commodities, but it doesn't make them go, oh my God, I can't wait to go to the next women's basketball game. So in that sense, it's counterproductive. And the only other thing I want to say here is, and we could talk about this maybe in the Q&A, because I know those who do this kind of research like I do always get this question, whether or not you think it's good or it's fine that women are portrayed this way in terms of sex cells or not, here's the question, right? Well, why are they allowing themselves to be portrayed that way? And I do want us to talk about that. But I also want to suggest the following, and especially for those of us who do critical feminist research in this area. At the macro level, a far more and fundamental question is this. Why are they routinely asked to do so? And in fact, at the end of this study, we asked the female athletes, if you could get the same amount of attention and corporate sponsorship for being portrayed in a competent way versus a sexy babe, what's the answer? And I can't tell you the answer because we're just now coding it. And maybe you'll invite me next year to tell you. But what I would suggest to you is who benefits from these sexually provocative images. What I want to say is that the last people on earth who benefit from these images are female athletes and women's sports. Thank you very much. And for those of you who want to see the whole manuscript, there it is online. Thanks. Now, do you have, you have a mic on? Okay. Do you want that?
Thank you. Nice job, Mary.
Thanks.
Yeah,
I was
under
my time. I think you said that.
1 minute.
Oh.
Wow.
I won't be able to see it.
Sets a standard for me.
All right, here you go. And your mic is on?
It is.
Okay, good.
24 minutes, perfect.
I'm on, right? The mic? Yeah, okay.
I just want to say one thing. Early on when we did this research at the Tucker Center at the University of Minnesota, speaking of pioneers of folks in sports, we were given money by the Women's Sports Foundation to conduct much of our early media research, and I want to give a shout out to Donald Opiano, who gave us money to do that for the Women's Sports Foundation.
That's nice, but it took 90 seconds of my time.
I'm sorry. No, I had 24 minutes. All right.
Okay. Well, welcome everybody, and I'm Mike Messner, and I'm a professor of sociology and gender studies here at USC. And I want to thank Dan Durbin also and USC Annenberg for inviting me to speak and for holding this conference and for inviting so many of my friends. It's really nice to be on a panel and really honored to be on a panel with Mary Jo Kane and Cheryl Cooky. On behalf of all of the Californians here, you know, to the visitors too, I want to apologize for the less than perfect weather. It's just really quite a shame. That's for you, Mary Jo, kind of digging yourself out of the snow to get here. I'm going to talk about. I guess my title says 40 years of Title IX, but I'm not going to talk too much about Title IX. It's more a talk about how we can think about boys in what you might think of as sort of post Title IX era, where we've had so much massive social change in girls and women's sports, and what I'm going to argue is not very much of a rethinking of boys. And I'm going to make three points. The first one, pretty quickly and simply, sort of outlines my perspective on thinking about sports. The second is how post-Title IX discourse tends to render boys invisible. And the third is to sort of look at current social changes to think about opportunities we might have to rethink boys, men, and masculinity through sport. So as to that first point, and that's what the little diagram on the right is kind of about, is that I always try to emphasize that scholarship that looks at sport as though it's some kind of contained world, which is kind of the way a lot of us experience sport. It's an escape from our daily lives. We go to the television to watch sport, or we go to play sport, or we go to watch sport, and it's kind of an escape from everyday life. It's really important to emphasize that even though lots of times people think of sports that way, what scholars do when we study sport is we try to think of sport in the way that it interrelates with other aspects of life. So with politics, with the mass media, and so forth. But I'm not going to talk too much about the media today. Most of what I'm going to talk about comes from research that I've done that looks at youth sports and the connection between youth sports and families and workplaces. And then the broader sort of social aspects of sport point that I would make just as a starter is that I and a good number of other people for many years have thought of sports as a sort of contested terrain of gender identities and meanings, you know, compared with when I was growing up in a post-World War II era where sport was primarily and pretty clearly a field dominated by and for men and boys. In the post-Title IX era, we've seen so many, just this huge, massive movement of girls and women into sports, and it's really become not so clear that that the institution of sports just constructs and reinforces ideas of male superiority anymore. Women's presence in sports and girls' presence in sports really challenges traditional ideas of male superiority. And as research by Don Sabo and other people has shown, sports is a field of potential empowerment now for girls and women. And a lot of the research that's been done on sort of the post-Title IX position of girls and women in sports and their families really points to that sort of change in people's attitudes and approaches to thinking about their daughters in sports, which I'll have a little bit more to say about in a little bit. And what I'm going to suggest and argue is that we're at a point in history where the way we think about boys and men in sport, it can kind of go one or either way, or it can go both ways. And I'd argue in some ways it is going in both directions. In one way, sports becomes a site of retrenchment of dominant conceptions of masculinity, retrenchment for men's feelings of superiority and power over women, and a site where there's a backlash against feminism and a backlash against girls and women's empowerment. I guess, you know, the rise in popularity of combat sports I would point to as maybe one example of that. And youth sports in particular becomes a place where we can start to rethink boys and men and reshape conceptions of gender for boys and that'll be kind of my punchline at the end is some suggestions as to ways we might start thinking in that way a little bit more. So, first point out of the way. My second point, and I'm going to talk a little bit about I'm just calling this post-Title IX discourse, but it's probably in countries that didn't have Title IX. Title IX is very much a U.S. law, that there's been similar sorts of revolutions in girls and women's sports. In the United States, we really look at Title IX oftentimes as such an important marker and such an important legal statute that's helped drive schools and university towards equity for girls and women. At any rate, I'm going to draw a little bit from the findings for this book that I did a couple years ago. Well, it's a few years ago now, based upon several years of research on youth sports, basically soccer and baseball and softball, where I was looking more not so much at the kids, but at the adults and the adults' views of the kids mm-hmm. and how the adults treat the kids and think about the kids. I'll focus first on how adults talk about kids and gender, and this a lot of this came from. I'll share just a couple of interview examples from you, but through all of the observation, the several years of observation, I noticed adults, coaches, and assistant coaches, and parents treating the boys, treating the girls in quite different ways. in practices and games and the way they use their voices with them, the way they talk to them, the way they appear to try to motivate them and that sort of thing. And I thought that was very interesting. And when I got into doing interviews with youth sports coaches, I asked them a sort of general question of, like, you know, do you believe boys and girls should have the same opportunities to play sports? Everybody now says yes. And that's a big part of the post-Title IX discourse is everybody's on board that sports is good for girls just as it's good for boys. We want our daughters involved just as we want our sons involved. Should boys and girls have similar opportunities and be treated similarly? Yes, people agree with that too, that girls and boys should be treated similarly. But what I observed was they actually weren't treated quite the same, that there were quite distinct gender differences in the styles of coaching and the way people treated the kids. So that to me became an interesting thing to probe, is the belief in equal treatment and equal opportunity and yet the actual different treatment of boys and girls. And I probed this sort of in interviews with coaches. And when I talked to coaches about their attitudes towards girls and gender, and a lot of these, most of these people were parents, of course, and youth coaches who coached girls, and people, adults tended to have a really clear narrative about girls and sports, really, really, you know, articulate, and it seemed to me that there's this real clear narrative floating out around there now that adults have and parents have tapped into about how good sports are for girls, parents believe that sports that girls are very sort of flexible beings, that sports stretches them away from their natures, and there's still this sort of, you know, essentialist idea that girls are naturally softer and, you know, less aggressive than boys, yet sport kind of stretches them away from that, and that's good. And fathers are especially adamant about this because they know that their daughters are still facing a world as they grow up that's going to offer challenges to them, that there's glass ceilings, that there's sexual harassment and sexual assault and things like that. And a lot of parents expressed a lot of enthusiasm for the idea that sports is going to be something that empowers their daughters, that teaches them to be more aggressive and competitive, and compares them for a future life of choice. And I put that term choice in quotes because it became a key analytic concept for me. Adults talk a lot about girls facing future choices in their lives, and they see sports as one way for their daughters to develop the kind of skills and competitiveness to get out there in public life, compete in schools, and eventually compete in the work world. As I'll fill in a little bit more later, the idea is that these girls are also going to be facing future lives probably as mothers, and some of them of course won't, but many of them will. And the way their parents see this is that the girls, just like their mothers, are going to have to make some choices in the future about their careers, their work, their family life, and sort of straddle work and family life. So they want them to be prepared to have those sort of skills to make those kinds of choices. Now, when I asked people to talk about boys, it was really an amazing contrast. Ask people, adults, to talk about boys and gender, and suddenly people who are extremely articulate, tapped into a common cultural narrative about girls, become extremely inarticulate. I have a lot of examples in my interview transcripts of adults kind of stammering, starting a sentence, stopping a sentence, starting a sentence, stopping a sentence, trying to figure out, pick up a thread that sounded somewhat logical and smart about how to talk about boys and gender and sports. And oftentimes, many of them kind of just settled into eventually into some cliche about testosterone. You know, all those boys in the dugout, they're all full of testosterone, all that energy. We've got to tap that energy. And essentially what people say, this is actually my son's team right there too, and he's on the far right, and I'm sitting in the dugout taking notes. That was my greatest research position, studying youth baseball. Essentially people have this very powerful essentialist view of boys that boys are fairly simple creatures. They're as opposed to girls who have this sort of wide range of possibilities and this sort of web of connections and so forth. Boys are very linear, and that sports, therefore, there's nothing much to think about playing sports, because the sense is boys have always played sports. It's natural for boys to play sports. It's consistent with their competitive and aggressive natures. They're hardwired for aggression and competition in public lives, ultimately. And so it makes common sense for adults that boys are playing sports, which kind of washes out the fact that a lot of boys themselves wash out or quit sports along the way because it doesn't fit with their personalities. And one of my sons was incredibly humiliated by playing sports early on and got out as fast as he possibly could. So this is, for me, an interesting contrast in terms of the adults. And here's just a couple of quotes from male soccer coaches who had coached both girls and boys. And so I was asking them about their sense of how they motivate kids and what their different sensibility of what girls and boys are like. And the one guy says girls are very competitive and they can be very competitive. But their approach to a lot of sports is different than boys, and I think it's probably more pure. I mean, sometimes guys can get so doggone focused, myself included, that it becomes like this laser. And I think female athletes see a bigger field a lot of the time, see a bigger dynamic, more fluid give and take situation than boys. And then the other guy says they're very, very different in style. The girls tend to form a team easier. Boys have a much more competitive streak in them, more aggressive streak in them than the girls do. I think that changes a bit as the girls get older and become more trained or conditioned to behaving in a more aggressive way, even in showboating and taunting that can occur, like when they make a nice tackle and knock somebody down, glaring at the player on the ground. So over time, girls who would have been aggressive to some extent and competitive to some extent, I think, learn to become more so. And I think what happens is as they grow older, those who are willing to be more like that, more similar to the boys, stay in the sport. And I think that's where the similarities, they become more similar. So the idea is boys are kind of linear, fixed, naturally suited to playing sports, aggressive, competitive. The girls are not that much so, but sports kind of pulls them in that direction. There's a sort of sense of flexibility of girls and sports kind of pulling them that way. So kind of summing this up, adults talk about girls and the way this kind of fits into their views of their kids and future family life, their sort of projections of kids' future, is that what I call this is girls are sort of narrated in this post-Title IX narrative as pre-choice. Adults tend to think of their daughters as facing a world of choices. Sports is good for them then in helping them to sort of stretch them to be able to make these choices. And that these choices in adults' minds mirror the kind of choices that their mothers are making, that they themselves are making in their families, where the women, especially when the second child or third child has arrived, if they've had jobs and careers, find themselves often with a double work day. Several of the professional class women that I interviewed had either cut back to part-time or pulled out of work entirely when their second and third child were born. And they are very aware of having to straddle work and family lives with these sort of choices. And the men, none of the men that I interviewed did that, but they talk about their wives as making those choices and talk about being supportive of their wives. Whatever choice she makes, I'm fine with it. So it's clearly seen as the choice of the woman to the job of the woman to make these choices. Boys, I think, are sort of narrated by adults as pre-career. It's just believed that boys are naturally going to be moving into public life, and just as in the past, sports helps prepare them to move into public life. It's consistent with their destinies and their essential nature, in other words. So I call this soft essentialism because it's not as hard an essentialism as the post-World War II era time when you have this clear public-domestic split, sports for boys, public life for men, no sports for women or for girls, domestic life for women, at least, much more clearly so in the middle class. Working class women obviously were in the workforce and working and many of them playing sports during that period of time as well, but it wasn't recognized, and it was seen, as Mary Jo said, as kind of a deviant thing for women to do. One aspect of this I just want to touch on here in terms of the way boys are treated and girls are treated. I talked to coaches about motivational strategies with kids. And one guy who had coached both boys' baseball and girls' softball said, when I coached boys' baseball, it was a total different style. The boys are a little more rough around the edges, and you can talk to them a certain way, and they take it, and it just rolls right off of them. But the girls, no way. I'm boisterous. I have a big, deep voice, and I can yell at a kid across the field. I had some 9-year-olds on the team, and I did, come on, you know, and you see the little girls' faces, and you're thinking, I hurt this little girl's feelings. I'm sorry, you know, are you all right? And they're standing there, and they're quivering, and you're going, oh, my gosh. It's different. It's a different style. I had several quotes from coaches that were very similar to this, and it really struck me. I've talked to high school coaches, too, have coached both girls and boys, and they say similar sorts of things. And I'm sure that as a general sort of pattern of the sort of emotional response of boys and girls, they're right in terms of what they're seeing. But I really question the sort of assumptions underlying that boys are just by nature like that. And I think what we're seeing here is an emotional socialization of boys to taking, you know, that kind of criticism, or some people would possibly call it abuse. And I'll give you a very quick little vignette of, you know, and those of you who are ever going to do doctoral dissertations, I don't recommend you take 7 years in the field studying for your doctorate, but this study did take 7 years for various reasons, and it really benefited me ultimately being able to watch kids and following my own son through when he was 6 or 7 years old with T-ball all the way up through age 14, and watching the emotional changes, the way emotions are dealt with differently at different stages. So to give you a real common example in sort of three stages, a little boy is up at bat, and it's the last inning, and bases are loaded. If he gets a hit, he's the hero. If he strikes out, his team loses. He's the GOAT, you know. And he strikes out, okay? What happens when that happens to a 6 or 7-year-old? He's sad. He drops the bat. He trudges back to the dugout halfway there. He can't fight the tears back anymore. His tears are streaming down his cheeks. He's sobbing by the time he gets to the dugout. The coach comes and puts an arm around him and says, that's okay, buddy. You know, you gave a good swing. And he goes into the dugout, and the other kids might say something, too, to him. And it's perfectly acceptable to have that kind of emotional display. Pump that up about 2 or 3 years to age 10, and what happens is the kid strikes out. Same kid, poor kid. He walks back to the dugout again, and this time he fights off the tears, though. And you can tell he's shaking, but he kind of fights off the tears, and he goes in and he sits down in the dugout and he pulls the hat over his face. I've seen this happen a few times. Pulls the hat over his face and sits there to get himself under control. Everybody ignores him for a while because they give him the space to get his emotions under control. And then when he comes out of it and he's got himself under control, people say, we'll get him next time, you know. Age 12, 13, 14, this happened. The kid, he hasn't quit yet. He just keeps striking out. He strikes out again, and he walks back to the dugout. And halfway back to the dugout, he takes his bat and he flings it against the fence, and he says, fuck! And the coach says, no, you know, it's a good swing, but you don't want to. And the other kids come up, you know, come give him a pat on the back. So what's happened there? It's a developmental process where there's been a particular type of emotion that gets converted into an appropriately acceptable masculine emotion. Sadness, upset, gets converted into anger. And I think when coaches say, you know, like this guy does here, that they're rough around the edges and it just rolls right off of them, I think that's because they have been through that kind of a process of development. They've learned to suppress their own self-empathy, and they've converted their pain or sadness to socially appropriate masculine emotional displays. And, you know, I guess I'm not the only person to ever observe this sort of thing. You know, this Steve Moore, I think I have a couple more of his cartoons in here that for you to see as well, has seen this. And another one, and this is, you know, also related to what Don Sabo, sitting right here, is called the pain principle, that what boys and men learn through sports to suppress their own vulnerabilities emotionally, but also physically, and to stop whining. It's also what William Pollack, the psychologist, has called the hardening of boys, that there's this emotional sort of toughening up of boys that take place in sports, and coaches are oftentimes kind of stewards of the socialization process that toughens and hardens boys. Moving in for my sort of final points about rethinking boys in sports, and I want to touch on these three points separately. First, sport as preparation for adult life, and sort of how we as adults or people who work in youth sports with kids imagine sports as part of kids' future. And you know, adults do. I mean, we for the most part are really enthusiastic about our kids being involved in sports, and lots of times adults have pretty good reasons for thinking that it's a good thing for their kids to be involved in youth sports. But I think we need to think much more about boys, just as we have been thinking about girls. And I'm not saying it's a perfect world out there for girls in sports. But far from it. There's very good things for us to look at critically. But I think we've moved really far in the direction of really thinking about and developing a cultural discourse of what sports means to girls and what ways in which it might be a positive thing for girls. The second thing that you know I wanted to talk about is the emotions, boys' emotions and relationships, how sports can be a place to help build rather than to constrict boys' emotions and relationships, and to rethink health and injuries. How can we do this? First of all, I think you know thinking in a historical sort of way, it always helps to kind of look at what's happening. What are some of the current social changes that are taking place, and how does that create opportunities for action and change and kind of steering history in a certain direction? And you know the biggest social change in youth sports is the expansion of participation by girls. It's so good for boys to see competent girls and competent women playing sports, and when possible, to actually play with them. And you know, the greatest experience one of my sons ever had in sports was having a girl just slap a screaming line drive right by him and all of his teammates. You know, I think that experience very early on builds a sort of baseline respect for girls and women that boys of my generation didn't have the opportunity to build. So the opportunity I think that presents is a way of expanding boys, the way we think about boys' roles as partners with women, as future dads, and partners with women in workplaces as well, to think about equity and to think about respect for women. And to think about making choices in the future, just as women are going to have to make choices in the future about work and family life. And until men are sharing those tough choices in an equitable way about who cares for children when they arrive, rather than assuming that it's going to be left up to a woman, unless and until men are doing that, women cannot have equality in public life, because they're going to have that tug back to home responsibilities in a asymmetrical way. The second thing is that there's currently is an expansion of what a lot of people call involved parenting, involved fathering among men. This creates a real opportunity to rethink boys and men, and also, although I think we need to look at this carefully, in some contexts, and especially among younger people, a decline in homophobia among young people, and this creates an opportunity to think of sports not as a place where we limit boys' emotional repertoires, as we actually are doing now, and homophobia has often been the main mechanism for policing boys' emotional displays. Don't be a sissy, don't be a fag. And I think it gives us an opportunity to think of sports as a place of expanding our emotional repertoires. And the third thing is the growing awareness of concussions and the more general kind of costs of masculinity in general in society, the lower life expectancy of men, the various sorts of risks and dangers that men and boys subject themselves to. It gives us an opportunity to think about youth sports as a means of developing lifelong health and fitness for boys and for girls. So closing this out just with this third point, I wanted to say just a few things about the growing awareness of concussions and other long-time health-related problems that men in collision and combat sports we're now becoming much more aware of. And there's a lot of cultural discourse around, and you know, the NFL veterans or former players are suing the league and so forth. And there's a lot of talk about this in youth sports. And this article about the Bob Probert who died in 2011 was very famous for being a kind of enforcer on the ice. It struck me as such a powerful image, partly because his head is bloodied. That's perfect, thank you. His head is bloodied, and it's a sort of an indicator of the kind of player he was, I guess. I don't follow this sport at all, but the photo of the little boy behind the glass just struck me as so powerful. He's fully enjoying this moment, and I said I wasn't going to say much about the media, but I think this is when we think about kind of media frames of big sporting events, whether it's a big hockey match or a playoff football game or the NBA playoffs or a bowl football game, the big ones at the end of the season, the way they take a little extra time at the beginning of each show to frame that and make it a much more exciting event for you. Oftentimes, one of the threads of that is to talk about the guy who's playing hurt, the guy who's dragging his leg out there. He probably shouldn't be playing, but he's going to give up his body for the team. And we lift up those guys as heroes. And I think that's something that we need to seriously rethink in terms of what kind of lesson that is for kids. The research question that I think is really interesting right now with youth sports would be, how are families going to respond to this new knowledge in terms of their kids and football? And their kids in other sort of sports, perhaps, that might be lead to higher levels of concussions. Are parents going to be bailing out of football or telling the kids they can't play football because of this new knowledge? Now, organizationally, there are responses to this happening. I just got this off the Pop Warner football website a few days ago that they claimed that 275,000 kids played Pop Warner football in 2012, and this is a quote from the executive director who said, about Pop Warner, we've been growing each year. This is our 22nd season for which we have data, and we've been up 19 of those 22 years. This year was flat, so under the circumstances, that's not bad. I think football's not going to go away. Under the circumstances, he's talking about the growing awareness of concussions, and he also talked about in that same statement that Pop Warner is trying to institute rules to keep kids from having full-speed collisions, and they're working on their equipment. And he said that the problems, the concussions are really happening more at the next level with middle school, but not here. And I thought, even if that is true, if we think of Pop Warner football as the beginning of the pipeline, we should be thinking about whether even if kids are not that often getting seriously hurt in Pop Warner football, we should be thinking about interested as researchers in exploring how parents are thinking about that as the sort of opening of the pipeline, feeding kids into the pipeline there, where later they might get concussions if they aren't getting them here. And so I think this is a really good way to sort of think about rethinking the future of boys in sports and the future of girls in sports. And I won't go into this, but maybe I'd be interested to hear more about what you're thinking in terms of this question of parents responding to the new research on concussions. But my guess is that middle-class parents, professional-class parents have already been doing that for some time, trying to divert their kids away from football, or now even increasingly doing it. But poor kids and from poor families probably are still going to see football as a possible route to upward mobility. And so rather than this beautiful United Colors of Benetton sort of feeling that we get from this photo of that all... Final sentence. That all of these kids are, we should all think of them together. We should think of boys and girls. We also need to think also of social class and race, ethnicity in terms of how that might shape the way adults respond to these to youth sports as a sort of opportunity versus as a danger for their kids. And it'll be real interesting to see how that's shaped in coming years in terms of the differences among social class groups. Thank you very much.
Okay, great. Thank you for all of you for being here today. Don't leave. I know you all have class at 1, so unfortunately you're going to miss out on a great presentation. But I just wanted to thank, miss your class instead and stay here. I wanted to thank Professor Durbin, the Annenberg School of Communication at the University of Southern California, for inviting me here today. I'm an alumnus of USC. Right on. So it's really great. This has been wonderful to be back on campus, and it's a really nice homecoming. Today I wanted to discuss with you some research that I actually got involved with as a graduate student here at USC. Professor Michael Messner, who we just heard from, was my dissertation advisor, and so I was a graduate assistant on this longitudinal study back in 1999, so I'm dating myself a little bit here. And now have gotten involved as a professor and a collaborator with Dr. Messner. So for graduate students, if you're working on projects, you never know what it is that you might, you know, be doing. So make sure you do a good job, because it could be your future research agenda. So it's been a pleasure to work with Mike on this project, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the findings from this report and that really resonate with many of the themes that were discussed in the previous presentations, as well as in some of the earlier presentations, if you had a chance to go to Michelle Donnelly's presentation yesterday. So the theme for this particular panel is on image representation in Title IX, and so I want to situate the talk with kind of a framing of Title IX. Those of you that aren't aware, Title IX is a U.S. law that states that no person in the United States shall, on the basis of sex, be denied or be excluded from participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be subjected to discrimination under any educational program or activity receiving federal financial assistance. Now, those of you that are familiar, how many of you have heard of Title IX? Before. Okay, so you've heard of this, and we all know probably some of these stats and trends that Title IX has had a tremendous impact in terms of the increase of girls and women who are participating in high school and collegiate sports. So what we know is that prior to Title IX's passage, one out of every 27 girls participated in high school sports, and today that number is, you know, one out of every 2.5. I'm not a statistician. I don't know how you get half of a person, but that's how the numbers work out. So the bottom line there is girls are participating in sport in greater numbers than ever. Prior to Title IX, there was just under 300,000 girls who participated in high school sports. Today, that's over 3 million. Tremendous increase in girls participating and young women participating in collegiate sports as well. So Title IX has had a tremendous impact in terms of participation. It's also had a tremendous impact in terms of shifting the cultural acceptance of female athleticism. And Professor Dworkin, Shari Dworkin, who's going to be speaking tomorrow, has written a book called Built to Win, where she talks about the increased cultural acceptance of female athleticism in the media and popular culture. So it's really Title IX, although the law itself doesn't legislate that we become more accepting of female athleticism, clearly the increased explosion of girls and women participating has shifted the ways that we think about girls and women in sport, as Professor Messner talked about earlier. So despite the tremendous impact that Title IX has had, there's a persisting inequality, several persisting inequalities that plague girls and women's sports, one of which I'll focus on today, which is the lack of media coverage. Professor Kane mentioned, right, that one of the persisting trends in the 30-plus years of scholarship in the area of gender, sports, and media is the fact that women's sports are not covered, right? And so although broadcast coverage of sport has increased and improved the quality and the quantity, so if you just turn on ESPN and you want to catch, you know, a WNBA game, you want to catch a women's softball game, you can actually find women's sports broadcast on television. But in terms of the news media representation and how female athletes get represented in other media outlets, right, we still see that particular representation and coverage hasn't necessarily translated into improved and respectful coverage in print, televised, and online news media. Now, there are some research studies that are out there that show that in smaller markets, media markets, and more niche markets, specialty markets that there are some improvements with respect to coverage and respectful coverage of girls and women's sport. However, I think we need to be cautious in terms of how this gets interpreted. Those are smaller niche markets, and so that we can ask questions about whether or not those actually challenge the dominant ways that girls and women's sports is presented in the media. So despite the increased participation of girls and women in sport as a result of Title IX, despite the increase in professional leagues for women, and the growing popularity of women's sports among sports fans, there are consistent patterns, as I've mentioned, that illustrate the lack of news media coverage that persist over time. So those are, as we kind of talked about earlier, how women's sport are silenced and marginalized, trivialized, and sexualized. So why does this occur? Why does this happen? The common sense assumption, I think, that people often operate under is that the news media are giving viewers what they want. I mean, this is really kind of a very, you know, in some ways, simple economic supply and demand kind of model, right? So the fact that, you know, all this 30-plus years of scholarship in the field of sports and media has shown that women don't get covered, or women are marginalized, or women are trivialized. Well, that's just because, you know, that's what viewers want to see. We either don't want to see women's sports, or we want to see women's sports portrayed in particular kinds of ways. However, what Mike and I argue is that the amount of coverage and the quality of coverage contributes to a particular reception of sports, one that builds and sustains audience interest and demand for men's sports while constraining audience interest for women's sports. So in other words, the media play a real powerful role in setting the agenda, building audiences, and constructing interest in sports. Right? So there's not, people aren't just innately drawn to men's sports. There's a reason why, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that today. So some of the research questions that were driving this particular project, we were really concerned with in this longitudinal study, the amount of coverage given to men's sports and women's sports, how production values differ in terms of the coverage of men's sports compared to women's sports, the quality of coverage and commentary. Are women's sports covered in ways that highlight athletic competence, as Professor Kane talked about? Or are they portrayed in ways that trivialize women's sports? And we are also, again, because this is a longitudinal study, we were concerned with whether or not, to what extent, there's been any changes over time. So this study began in 1989. I was not involved in that particular segment of the data collection. But we sample every 5 years the coverage of men's and women's sports within the local affiliates here in Los Angeles. And then ESPN was added in 1999. And we looked at the 6 p.m., 11 p.m. broadcasts, the 11 p.m. broadcast of SportsCenter, and then, again, as I said, every 5 years, looking in March, July, and November to get kind of a scope of the various sports that are in season over the year. So what we're doing, and I want to emphasize this here for you all, we weren't necessarily selecting particular sports. We weren't like, oh, let's see how they cover football. What we did was we turned on the TV, we tuned into KABC, KNBC, KCBS, and just looked at what is it that they're talking about. And I had the pleasure as a graduate student to sit and count how many minutes, how many seconds for each segment, which was a pleasure to do. Luckily, now that I'm a big time professor, I've got, you know, graduate students, and Mike's got graduate students that do that for us. But so very, very fascinating. So I want to talk to you today about the major findings from this particular study, and this is just kind of giving you a little outline for the rest of the presentation. So major findings: women's sports coverage is at its lowest level ever in the last iteration of the study in 2009. Women's sports are marginalized on the ticker. So you're all familiar with what the ticker is? And how many of you watch SportsCenter or the local news, sports No one watches the local news, but okay, some of you watch SportsCenter, right? So the ticker is a little kind of scrolling bar at the bottom of the screen where you see like the highlights, the scores, who got traded. You know, Oscar Pistorius was arrested for you know the little kind of highlights and major events of the day, right? So women's sports are marginalized on that ticker. The men's big three are the central focus. Messner talks about this as the institutional center of sports. So sports, men's basketball, football, and baseball. We saw an unequal coverage of similar men's and women's sports. Shifting portrayals of women, question mark. How do you have a question mark after your findings? I'll talk about that. And then we looked at the composition, race, and gender of the commentators. So the first finding that I want to talk to you about is the declining coverage of women's sports. This particular graph here illustrates the coverage on the local affiliates, so KABC, KNBC, KCBS. This does not include the ticker coverage. So this is just main coverage, what's being broadcast, what we're seeing on the TV, what the commentators or the anchors are talking about. So what's going on here? The green is in neutral, considered neutral sports. Red is men's sports. And blue is the women's sports, for those of you who can't read that in the back. But you might not be able to see the numbers, but what's going on here? Does anybody want to join in on the conversation?
The majority of men.
Yeah, the majority of coverage is on men's sports. Good. What else are we seeing?
There's a decline in women's sports as time has gone on.
Yeah, decline in women's sports as time has gone on. Does this seem surprising to any of you? Given what I've just talked about with respect to the growth of girls and women's participating in sport, we would expect, okay, so 1989 is the first timeline, right? That's what, somebody do the math for me, that's what, 15, 16 years after Title IX was passed? Nine, carry the one, right? So you know, you might think like, okay, well, this is, you know, we're still seeing that generation of Title IXers coming, you know, to the fore, and but as the time goes along, we would think that we'd see more women's sports covered, and in fact, that's not the case. So very surprising findings. This is what the data looks like split or sliced up in terms of the network versus SportsCenter. So again, that you see that sort of decline in coverage, and then SportsCenter has relatively remained, you know, the coverage is relatively abysmal over time, but has somewhat declined in the last 10 years since we've been doing this study. The second major finding that I want to talk about is how it is that women's sports are marginalized. And so what we did was to look at, okay, what's happening within the ticker coverage. And so here again, similar kinds of trends. There's KCBS and KNBC on the right. ESPN SportsCenter is on the left. And the ticker coverage is 3.2 versus 2.7%. Relatively small percentages, but twice as much as what we see in terms of the main ticker coverage. KABC did not have a ticker as part of their production value, so that's why they're not reported. The ticker coverage also went down on KNBC and KCBS from 2004. That's not depicted on this particular chart, but it was about 8.5% in 2004, and now it's at 3.2%. Third major finding, men always lead. The men's big three sports were always the lead story. Why is this significant? Some journalism majors in the audience. Why would I care 100% of the coverages or the lead stories are on men? Y'all thought, you're like, we're not in class right now. We don't have to talk to you, right? Any guesses? Educated guess?
Lots of perverted vision.
No one knows. Oh, there we go. Yeah, yes, thank you, thank you.
Maybe it's the most watched portion of the show?
Yeah.
Either it's initial or most watched.
Yeah, so what we know is that the lead story, the story that makes the front page, is what gets counted as, or at least framed as, the most important story of the day, right? That's the story that the news media are suggesting is the top story, the most important story. So it's significant that 100% of the lead stories in our sample were on men's sports, right? So men's sports are always situated as the most important, the lead story of the day. About 68% of the total airtime, and this is both main and ticker, was focused on those three sports. So other men's sports get marginalized as well, right? Men's tennis, men's golf, men's soccer, and so on. But the men's three sports, big three, always are dominating, even when they're not in season. So when football is out of season, when basketball is out of season, they're still taking up the majority of airtime within the news media coverage. Now, some people would say, well, there just isn't really a lot going on in women's sports in your sample, perhaps, right? And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But a couple of big stories that were happening in March in 2009, in the latest sample, we had UConn and their undefeated season. Women's UConn basketball was undefeated that season. Maya Moore, who was a first-round draft pick, was dominating the game. There was a lot of exciting narratives. What's interesting is that in men's sports, when you have an undefeated team, right, that becomes a dominant narrative and how that gets covered. And, wow, it's exciting. And what I heard when I talked to people, colleagues, about this work is that when that happens in women's sports, particularly women's basketball, it's seen as like, oh, well, no one watches women's basketball because we all know who's going to win. It's either going to be UConn, it's going to be Tennessee, it's going to be Stanford, so who cares? We already know who won the game. Okay, but anyway, that's a whole other story. There was also the WNBA All-Star Tournament happening during our sample, World Championship Figure Skating, the U.S. Open LPGA Tour was happening during this time frame, as well as World Cup Softball. So it's not as if the news media had nothing to cover with respect to women's sports. What we also did was we took within our sample the stories and segments where men's and women's comparable men's and women's sports were covered. So we looked at the amount of coverage of similar men's and women's sports, the WNBA and the NBA, is depicted in this particular slide. So what we found was that the WNBA received a fraction of coverage with respect to the coverage of the NBA. So if we're looking here, about 6 minutes in the total sample was spent talking about the WNBA, whereas almost 2 hours, or 153 stories, were focused on the NBA. Going back to that in-season, out-of-season, when, and this is probably not that surprising, but when the WNBA is out of season, they're not covered. However, when the NBA is out of season, over an hour or nearly an hour and 81 stories or segments focused on the NBA. What we also saw, too, kind of resonating with the earlier finding that I discussed with women's sports being marginalized, is that 70 of the 78 segments were relegated to the ticker coverage. Okay, so this particular slide, we also looked at the NCAA tournament, March Madness basketball tournament. How many of you watched the final four games, the NCAA tournaments, men's, women's? Okay, interesting. All right, so what we see here, those of you that might not be able to read, the middle column represents NCAA men's basketball. The column to the right represents women's NCAA basketball. That first row is the main coverage on the local affiliates, and then right below that is the ticker. And then that third row is ESPN SportsCenter, main coverage, and ticker. So what's happening here? The local affiliates, there were no stories on the women's tournament in our sample. Zero stories. Whereas there was, you know, over an hour and 17 minutes of main coverage on the local affiliates. ESPN SportsCenter, we see a very similar trend, although there were a few more stories of the NCAA tournament. However, those compromised about 1 minute 12 seconds within our sample. Again, we're seeing some stories relegated to the ticker there as well. So nearly 3 hours of coverage of the tournament on ESPN SportsCenter and about 6 minutes for the women's tourney. Now, this is surprising in some ways, maybe not so much, but some may speculate, well, the men's tournament's really big, it's huge, it's this moneymaker. Of course the media is going to spend a lot of time talking about that. The women's tournament, maybe not so much. They just don't have enough time to focus on the women's tournament because they're spending so much time talking about the men. Does it sound like a legitimate argument? Maybe, maybe not. What was interesting is that within this time frame, so we also looked at, well, what else were they covering? What else were they talking about? On March 23rd, KNBC had a segment about a 5,000-calorie burger that you could buy at the minor league, a minor league baseball park in Michigan. Okay, this was a 30-second segment on the local news. How long is the local news sports segment usually? 2 to 3 minutes long, right? Really short. They spent 30 seconds talking about a burger. 0 seconds talking about women's sports. So again, it's not like, oh, they were talking about the men's tournament. They just didn't have the time, right? That says something. Burgers are more important than women. On March 24th, KABC ran a 1.5-minute segment on the 70th anniversary of Little League Baseball. Again, kind of what's important here. In terms of the qualitative analysis, what we found, so when women are actually entering into the frame, when women's sports are being covered, we looked at, well, how are they being covered? What's the quality of the coverage? What's the quality of the commentary? What stories get talked about? What we did find in the 2009 study that seemed to be somewhat of an improvement in comparison to previous studies was that there were these sort of rare moments of respectful coverage of women's sports. ESPN had a Women's History Month segment where they highlighted and featured various female athletes and talked about their accomplishments. What was interesting about these sort of celebrating women's history sports segments within ESPN SportsCenter is that they occupied this really interesting liminal space between the actual content on SportsCenter and the commercials. So that these segments weren't embedded within the ESPN SportsCenter programming, but rather were situated immediately after the SportsCenter programming, but yet before the commercial. Right, so it was really kind of hard to figure out, like, is this an advertisement? And I remember Mike and I talking about this. Do we code this as an advertisement? Do we code this as a commercial? Is this part of the content? So it was sort of this interesting liminal space. But, you know, albeit a respectful representation of women's sports. We also saw the kind of sexualized gag stories that we had seen in previous research studies, which you can find online if you're interested. That those kind of sexualized gag stories and representations had declined in this particular segment, the 2009 segment. Going back to that declining percentage of girls and women, so the highest peak that we saw was in 1999. About 9% of the coverage was on women's sports. A lot of that had to do with the fact that there were all these kind of humorous, sexualized stories. So once the percentage declined, we see those stories going away, but then we see the content going away as well. So it's almost as if the news media said, all right, well, if we can't sexualize you as athletes, if we can't make fun of you as athletes, then we'll just, you know, not cover you at all. So, I mean, it's good that it's declined, but then also they didn't replace it with increased coverage of actual women's athletic competence. Fights, scandals, and controversies often enter into the frame. I can talk a little bit more about that in the Q&A because I think I'm getting a little bit short on time here. We do see women represented as girlfriends, wives, and mothers in very traditional roles. So female athletes are either represented in these ways or women enter the frame as girlfriends or mothers of male athletes. There's also some negative depictions of men as well. There were some controversies that entered into the frame, Ben Roethlisberger and the rape case, a couple of other issues. What's different about these stories is that these stories happen within a broader landscape of coverage of men's sports, so they don't stand out as much. If you only have 1% of the coverage or 2% of the coverage on women's sports, and all we're hearing are the controversies, the fights, the scandals, or the sexualized stories, or stereotypical portrayals of women, that says something, that's significant. In terms of the commentators and anchors, this is the gender and racial composition. And so we're kind of interested in who is responsible for producing, or at least who's responsible for conveying this information and involved in the reporting. And this is very similar to some of the trends that Richard Lapchick at the is it the University of South Florida, Central Florida, has found with his gender and race sport card that he puts out. So the network affiliates in terms of gender diversity, again, abysmal, but fairly diverse in terms of racial and ethnic composition. ESPN SportsCenter tends to do a bit better with respect to gender diversity, and to some extent, some racial diversity, but not as great as the local affiliates. So in terms of takeaway points, and I'll wrap up here, the increased participation of girls and women in sport has not translated into increased televised news media coverage, at least within this particular sample. And in fact, it's declined. So the lack, what we argue is that the lack of coverage helps to maintain the myth that sports are exclusively by, about, and for men. TV sports, news and highlight shows, sports print media, newspapers, and other media outlets actually build audiences for sport, and particularly for men's sports, in the ways that they create exciting, interesting commentary around men's sports. And this coverage serves as a promotion for men's sports. So it's not that the media are just giving viewers what they want. If ESPN's marketing research were to show that viewers are more interested in men's sports, our theoretical orientation leads us to examine how it is that this interest is socially constructed. The media are one institution among many that promotes men's sports while ignoring women's sports. Not acknowledging the important role that the media play in promoting men's sports through their coverage of visually and orally exciting highlights and commentary downplays the power that media institutions have to provide exciting and pleasurable experiences, which enhance the interest in and consumption of men's sports. Thank you. And I saw some of you taking notes. You can actually download this report online. It's going to be published in the journal Communication and Sport, which is a new journal that's coming out, so you should all subscribe to it so you can get it delivered to your mailbox at home. I'm sure you all do that. You can follow me on Twitter, and I'd like to thank and acknowledge those individuals and organizations that have been involved with and supporting this project, particularly the Center for Feminist Research at the University of Southern California. Thank you.
All right, does anybody have any questions?
I'm going to be a terrible audience member, largely because I wrote all of it. And I'm not going to have a question, but I have some statements. I have to ask, first of all, does anybody here have any relationship at all with ESPN? I mean, like, okay. A couple of things that struck me about your presentation. One was, I think what you do with this to reinforce the coverage has not only been abysmal, it's remained abysmal, and it's getting abysmaler, if you can call it that. I don't know any human being in the industry who would not say that ESPN is a pure old boys network, and it would not surprise any, your numbers would be the least surprising thing at all to anybody in the industry. The comparison of that to the local affiliates is a little problematic because they're local affiliates and they're not a national network. And I think their explanation, most likely, of the diminishing, and this is from folks I know in the local affiliates, is their budgets have been so horribly slashed, everybody's gone back to the conservative, you just cover the majors and do nothing else. And so they've run for cover financially. ESPN does not have that excuse. Mm-hmm. Beyond that, what I'd like to see is somebody take this up, future researchers, take this up. Fox One is launching now, the worst kept secret in all of sports media. The next national network, this is supposed to be a sports network, and it is supposed to challenge ESPN. Mm-hmm. I would like to see somebody take that up, and because Fox, the people at Fox, and I can tell you this directly from people who are inside the offices at Fox, they have pissed and moaned for years about this, about ESPN. It's an old boys network. They don't cover women's sports. I want to see if Fox One does any better at covering women's sports, or if that's what's that?
Yeah,
Yeah, I know. It would be very interesting to me to see if they live up to their complaints about ESPN. Because I have actually sat in their offices and talked to them. Yeah.
Who's the talk show host that was with Kelly?
Regis Philbin?
He's mm-hmm. doing one of the mm-hmm. shows. So, mm-hmm. but I think that tells you something.
Yeah, tells you that they're going to go for entertainment as opposed to journalism. One other thing, though, about the rare moments of pre-commercial mm-hmm. coverage. When I actually was working in media, that time slot. That the generic term was human interest. That time slot was for things that you couldn't fit into your regular broadcast screen. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It strikes me that if that was really consistent, it is in essence hiding women's sports in plain sight. That it doesn't fit within the stream, the narrative of ESPN's coverage or whoever's coverage. So this is a place to actually say that you put it in, but you're really, in essence, still hiding it mm-hmm. because it doesn't exist in that spot. That's kind of a, like I said, it was the interest spot because it was a place to have a story that could transition into the commercials because, you know, that was your throwaway story because people were going to be going up mm-hmm. getting coffee for the commercial. So I don't know how what was it, rare moments of...
Respectful
coverage. I don't know how respectful that really is.
Yeah, you
know?
Yeah.
In the end, structurally, I would question that.
Yeah, can I respond or just
yeah, please. Spouting off at the mouth, sorry.
The local affiliates and the constrained mm-hmm. budgets, and the comparison really emerged, and Mike, you were there, so mm-hmm. you can jump in or correct me, but when Mike and Margaret... Carlisle Duncan, who was the other kind of initial co-founder of this project, were doing this work. The response that they got when they presented some of the research in 89 and in 94, which at that time that the sample just focused on the local affiliates, the news media responded and the sports journalists responded, well, this is unfair. We only have 2 to 3 minutes to cover sports. Go look at ESPN. They have an hour, right? Quit placing the spotlight on us. And so that's when ESPN was added, and so that kind of comparison between what's happening in local markets, or ostensibly local markets versus national markets, that kind of comparison came about. But I think I'm a little bit less or more skeptical about the kind of constrained budgets, and I'm not saying that constrained budgets aren't a reality, but again, it becomes about what gets focused on. So yeah, it's okay, we only have resources to devote to sending anchors or commentators to the major events, but yet at the same time within our sample, again, there was that, the story about the 5,000 calorie burger. There was another story about a 2.5-year-old pool prodigy. I don't know, some little kid who plays pool. And that was an hour-long segment, and it involved, some camera crew going into the house and interviewing the parents. So, Yeah. And so I think of course there's limited budgets, and that is an issue. But again, I think there's money to be found mm-hmm. when those who are in power want to cover something. And so I think, asking the question of, is a hamburger more important than, the WNBA?
Well, that and the conservative thing you run back to is what you all believed in all along anyway. So mm-hmm. you're running back to essentially a gender-based gender-based production because that was what was comfortable to you all along. Mm-hmm. So it's still the same criticism holds true, but I think it's ESPN sets a very interesting dynamic because Fox One is now exists. There's another one on the East Coast that's going to try to create a national network, sport network, and there are about three or more in the offing that may or may not mm-hmm. really get off the ground. The one expanding media in all of the contracting media is sports. If these sports networks actually get off the ground, will they essentially follow ESPN's model, or will there be actual relatively equitable coverage in any way?
Mm-hmm. Well, you got a question?
Sorry.
Just two thoughts. One is, none of this is surprising to me, but what is surprising is that you track commentators or anchors, the gender of, as opposed to the people in charge of programming or the sports editor. Yeah. And there's been no research to suggest that it's any different now than it was 20 years ago, that what gets in front of you is purely a decision and reflects the interests of the sports editor. Mm-hmm. Period, end of story. Mm-hmm. You look at the AP research on that, which is, they started an annual or biannual study every, just recently, and it's single digit percent female in the sports editor's view. So all the programming decisions, all these guys are making decisions about covering what they like. Mm-hmm. Industry. Second point is when it comes to television, not necessarily print. The economic motivation to fuel and promote using news, those sports in which they've overpaid rights fees. And therefore, they have to drive public interest to the programming in which they have to recoup all those costs, is, I think, a front and center strategy for those companies. And I don't know if they ever admit it, but that's exactly what's driving it.
Mm-hmm. Well, we thought it was really interesting the last time around that we did this study, just looking at the ESPN coverage of the women's NCAA tournament, because this was a time when ESPN was actually starting to expand their coverage of actual games. And we thought, gee, it would be, if there's somebody with a smart marketing mind there, it would be in their interest to expand coverage on SportsCenter because it would drive audiences to watching the games, you would think. But it seemed like the left hand and the right hand there at ESPN were not really working in sync with each other.
There's even something more interesting, I think, at play in terms of this, the male sport culture and the support of women's sports, in that there's a schizophrenic worry on the part of the male sports establishment that the embracing of women's sports is going to somehow lower the male macho audience, that if I embrace something that they consider to be soft and not macho, women's sports, somehow I'm going to lose this male sport primary audience support, and they won't do it. You see it happen with Nike. You see it happen with all of the the macho men's brands. They refuse to to develop a women's brand. They've got to keep this macho Nike brand, right? And they won't really attach this or embrace it on the women's product because they're afraid of losing who they're going after. It's anti-brand theory to try to put Nike on women when Nike is macho male. Does that make sense?
You have a question from the audience?
Yeah.
In Professor Urban's class, we've talked about how sports are kind of interconnected with the communities that surround them, and how there's this web of the media, the reporters, the sports organizations, they're all kind of interconnected. Do you think this is more a problem on the media outlet side of not covering the sports, or that the communities haven't kind of gained this interest in the sports enough so that the media outlets can sell these subscriptions and advertisements? Because the media outlet is concerned with what sells and making the biggest profit, not in what may be the best morally or ethically right. So do you think this is more on the media side or the community side?
Which panel wants to address this?
Well, I want to address that, but it also is going to feed into something that Donald O'Brien has just been saying. You're asking the chicken and egg question, right? Because so many years ago we were told, well, you know, women just don't play sports very much, and so because they don't play sports, why would we cover them? Well, Title IX built them a ballpark and a baseball field and all kinds of things. And as I said to you in my comments, over 40% of all participants in this country are female. 43% of all student scholarships at the Division I level are given to females. And so the media not only don't cover women proportionally, but they present a false narrative that actually suppresses coverage of what is going on. And as Cheryl and others have said, it's also about building an interest and building an audience, so that when they're saying on the one hand, well, we have shrinking resources and shrinking dollars, did it ever occur to you to reach out to a new market that's desperate for coverage? Mm-hmm. So there's always going to be some excuse, which is really the point that I want to make here, is that a number of people in this room have talked about the role of sport in this culture in terms of its relationship to hegemonic masculinity, and that this is not a random occurrence that they're ignoring women. because I had so many people over the years, so many reporters say to me, well, you know, Dr. Kane, it's just that nobody's interested, until I realized that the referent for nobody was them. They're not interested, but a lot of us are interested. And I really think that one of the things that we need to start talking with the media about, which is what you're talking about in terms of branding, is I think those who produce and cover women's sports, their greatest concern is that not that nobody's interested in women's sports, but that if they covered women's sports proportionally to how much we play, and in respectful coverage like they give the men, the biggest concern is that men's sports would no longer be the center of the universe, and that's really what this is about. This is about power and suppressing women in sport and the role that sport can play in empowering women. And I think that that's exactly, and I'm not saying they get up in the morning and go through this analysis, okay, but the end result is they ignore, you know, the better we get, the more they ignore us. The more we play, the more they ignore us. And that's exactly what's going on here. No matter what they say, that's what's going on.
He has a question.
Yes, so this is an anecdote that Mike would take me every once in a while to the women's basketball game at USC. I think he, because he felt sorry for me, I don't have much of a social life.
Nobody else would go with me in those days.
Oh. The sad thing is I was a sixth choice. But what really struck me is that he took me to the Pac-12 now?
Yeah, Pac-12.
Pac-12 women's basketball tournament being held at USC in Los Angeles. And he invited me to go to the USC one, and he invited me to go to the game the next day. And I got really excited, and that night I made a point of watching the local sports news to see who else had survived that first round, and waited eagerly to find out, you know, who USC would be playing. Not a word. So in terms of promoting community interest, I'm like, what more? And there was nothing else going on in terms of men's sports. There wasn't. God knows they would have covered the Pac-12 tournament, but
sure.
But one quick question. I was really interested in your talk, Mike. The changes in youth sports that have opened things up a bit. Some people have argued that we have less reason to be optimistic because adults control organized sports and organized youth sports. And I was wondering, in some of the research you've done or anybody else, how many of these youth coaches are parents of the kids? Because from a lot of the anecdotal literature anyway, those coaches tend to be the source. I mean, when I was growing up, I grew up in Williamsport, Pennsylvania, the Little League Baseball. My dad was my coach, which turned out to be a disaster for me. But they tend to have some of the worst stereotypical notions of sports. And if Mark Hyman and those people are believed, it's those adults who control sports that either educating them, having coaching certification programs, or getting more educators involved in new sports, or turning to free play. Does that come up at all?
That sort of came up in my interviews. And the vast majority of the youth sports coaches in the community I was studying were parents. And they're part of, most of them, sort of a middle to professional class group of parents who have a great deal of nostalgia for, I don't want to say an imagined time. It was quite real for them, as it was for me in my childhood, a time when kids had a lot more free play time and the idea of kind of playing on the driveway, or playing at the park, or playing out in the street. Kids organize games, and there's, you know, been a lot of talk in, you know, sport sociology and anthropology about the, you know, the difference between play and organized sports, or sort of more spontaneous play and organized sports. And so I think these parents have a lot of nostalgia for that, but at the same time, they're also part of a cohort of parents that have a lot of fear about the dangers that the world presents to their kids, and they're part of that sort of over-organized generation of parents and kids, and so sports becomes one other thing that these parents do in sort of kind of corralling and organizing their kids in much more sort of regimented activities, and including with the professional class parents, you know, buying their kids, you know, pitching coaches and a batting coach, and, you know, getting specialized training on the side, and rushing to the music practice and that sort of thing. So that, you know, with the sociologist Annette Leroux calls the concerted cultivation of middle class kids, and sports, youth sports becomes part of that kind of concerted cultivation.
Yeah, okay, great. Sorry, we are ridiculously out of time. We have a few minutes in transition. You can ask on our way down. However, first of all, I want to invite everybody to the 2 o'clock session in the Annenberg Auditorium, where Dr. Andrew Billings from the University of Alabama will be talking about. He'll be talking about the 2012 Olympics, correct? Hold on. As we mentioned in here, Nike wants to place its swish on everything apparently masculine. And we had marketers from Coca-Cola at the 1984 Olympics come and speak at our Olympics conference last year. They mentioned painting the entire town of Los Angeles red for Coca-Cola. One thing that we want to do is paint the entire academic world, USC, Annenberg Institute of Sports, Media, and Society. So we want to thank all of our guests here with just a little gift and token of our appreciation for taking the time to speak with us. And we want these all proudly displayed in whatever place you proudly display your proudly displayed items. We need to run downstairs. Andy and I are going to run ahead of everybody and get him set up. And hope to see you there in just a few minutes.